Welcome back to Learning Journal. We have been learning Spark examples using the REPL. Now it's time to show you a method for creating a standalone Spark application. In this video, I will create a simple example and help you to understand the process of creating Spark applications. We will also cover how to deploy your application on a Spark cluster. So, let's start. Scala is the Spark's native language, and hence, we prefer to write Spark applications in Scala. However, before you start writing Spark applications, you need to decide on your choice of the build tool. You have two popular options, SBT and Maven. I prefer using SBT for Apache Spark applications. You can also use Maven. However, I find SBT more simple and easy to use. You can download and install SBT from the SBT website. If you need more details for installing SBT, you can refer my video tutorials on how to install SBT. I am assuming that you have already installed and configured SBT and you are familiar with the build process. Every SBT project needs a build.sbt file. There are many things that a complicated project build might require you to configure in the build.sbt file. However, there are three main things that you must include in your build file: project metadata, dependencies, and repository resolvers. Here is an example of my simple build.sbt file. The build file must be placed in your project home directory. So, I have kept it in my project directory. Let's look inside the build.sbt. The first four lines are to define the project metadata. We give a name and a version to our project. We also define the organization name. The next important decision is to define your Scala version as well as Spark version. For a Spark project, these two are critical values. Both of these are used to resolve the appropriate packages. You need to choose these values based on your target cluster. So, if your production cluster is using Spark 2.2 for Scala 2.11, then you should select those versions accordingly. I am going to execute my example application on my local mode cluster. So, I need to make sure that the Spark and Scala versions of my build is in sync with my target cluster. There are many ways to check the Spark version. However, you can quickly check your Spark and Scala versions for your cluster using the Spark shell. The next part is to define the dependencies. In this example, we are adding Spark Core and Spark SQL. However, you might need to add other dependencies like Spark MLlib, Spark Streaming, Spark Hive, etc., depending upon your application. In case of our example, the SBT will search for following two packages. If you carefully look at the package name, the package name includes the Scala version 2.11 and the Spark version 2.2.0. And that's why knowing your target cluster version and defining your Spark and Scala versions are critically important. The last thing is to define a repository resolver. SBT comes with a predefined Maven repository. So, if your dependencies are available in Maven, then you don't need to specify a custom resolver. We only set the dependencies and SBT already knows where to look for those artifacts. Most of the Spark artifacts are available in Maven repository. So, you might not even need to define a custom resolver. However, for learning, let's add a new dependency that is not available through standard Maven repo. I am adding Kafka Avro Serializer by Confluent. and this artifact is not available in the standard Maven repository. There is one more important point to note here. The Kafka Avro serializer is a Java artifact, and the package doesn't include Scala version in its name. So, we don't want to add the Scala version in the package name. And hence, we use a single percent symbol here. In this case, the SBT will look for the following artifact. The effect of removing the percent symbol is that it doesn't include the Scala version in the artifact name like earlier. Great. Now I must configure a dependency resolver for this artifact. And that's what the next line defines. We define that the SBT should also look at the following URL for the required dependencies. However, this dependency is not needed for our example. I added it here to show you an example. But for now, let's remove it from our build file to avoid unnecessary downloads and potential conflicts. Great, that's all about the build file. We are now ready to write our Spark application code. In an ideal case, we need a project directory structure. So, the Scala source code should reside inside the SRC main Scala directory. Let's create the necessary directory structure and a test.scala file. Great! We are ready to write some code. I am assuming that you already know Scala. If not, I have an excellent tutorial for Scala. Start learning today. We want to create a command line Spark application. And that's the essential requirement to be able to submit the application to a Spark cluster. If you know Scala, you already know that we can create a main method in a Scala object. Scala classes do not allow us to create a static method. So, let's create a Scala object. If you know Scala, you already know that the all static methods in Scala go to an object. Now, let's create a main method. Okay, now your Spark code goes here. When we work on a REPL, we already have a Spark session object ready to use. However, for a Spark application, you need to create a Spark session. That is simple. We have a Spark session class and a companion object. Let me show you the documentation. Just leave the class for now and let's look at the companion object. The Spark session companion object offers you a builder method that returns a builder object. The builder object provides a bunch of methods to set various properties for a Spark session and ultimately create a new session. Let's see how we do it. Create a Spark session companion object that gives a builder object. Now we are ready to set some properties. The first one that I want to define is the name of my application. What else? All these config methods are there to allow you to set some Spark configurations. However, I don't want to hardcode configurations in my applications until it makes sense to define it from inside the application. So, let's leave the configurations. I'm not going to define any of the configs in my code. I want to enable the Hive support for this session, so let's do that. You can also specify the Spark master node details, but again, I don't want to hardcode. Basically, we want to be able to submit it to any Spark cluster and specify Spark master at the time of submission. So, let's leave that also. Finally, we call the get or create method. We do not have an existing Spark session in this application, so the method will create a brand new Spark session. Now the Spark session should be available to the value Spark. We can use this session to work with Spark cluster in the same way as we worked in the REPL. Great! You are now ready to write some code and do something meaningful. I don't want to write a lot of code. However, I want to mimic a popular use case. We want to load some data, perform some transformations, and finally save the results as a table to be consumed by the downstream system. That's it. Let's do that. Load the data from a JSON file and register it as a temporary table. Now we are ready to perform some SQL-based transformations on this data. Let's calculate the age frequency. Now we want to write the output as a database table, right? That's it. Let's close the session. And our Spark application is ready. We will compile it and package it as a jar file. Then we will submit it to Spark cluster and go back to Spark SQL command line to check if the survey frequency table is there. Great. Let's compile and package the application in a jar file. Execute the following SBT command. That's it. The jar file is ready and it is available in the target directory. Now we are ready to submit this application to our Spark cluster. Let me execute it in a local cluster. The name for the tool to submit Spark application is the Spark Submit. As the first parameter, we tell it about the Spark master. We are using a local mode Spark cluster and hence the value is local. If you are using a standalone cluster manager that comes along with Spark, you would be using a URI for your master node in the below format. If you are using a Mesos managed Spark cluster, you will be using a URI like below. However, in most likely case, you will be using a YARN managed cluster. I have already explained the Spark application behavior in a YARN cluster. In a YARN cluster, there is no Spark master. We submit our application to YARN and then the YARN starts an application master in a container. And hence, if you are submitting your application to a YARN cluster, all you need is to say the following. You don't have to specify a master URI. Just tell YARN, as we said, local. That's it. Rest of the parameters to Spark Submit are straightforward. We specify the object name for our application. Then specify the location of the application jar file. And finally, pass the command line arguments. That's it. Let's hit the enter button. It will take few seconds to complete. Now you can go back to Spark SQL command line tool or the Zeppelin notebook and check the output table. Amazing, isn't it? Thank you very much for watching Learning Journal. Keep learning and keep growing.